In part one of lecture seven, we will discuss the origin and the infrastructure of the internet. The internet began as the answer to the question, how do we keep computer networks working in the event of a limited global nuclear war? The idea was that a completely decentralized computer network could continue working even after the destruction of a large portion of the network. It was going to be a very large mesh network with a very large number of redundant pathways. The internet was a part of a much larger push for the United States to improve its scientific and technical infrastructure after the Soviet Union's launch of Sputnik, the first man-made satellite. This included a major overhaul of science education from elementary schools all the way through college. The work on what later became the Internet was started by the Defense Department's Advanced Research Projects Agency. Unlike the research sponsored by the Army, Navy, and Air Force, which was mostly applied work, ARPA funded basic research. This was necessary because no one had seriously considered how to build a network that would be as extensive as ARPANET, as it was known back then, would become. Scientists in both private industry and academia both worked on various parts of the project. ARPANET came online in 1969, connecting computers at UCLA, the Stanford Research Institute, the University of Utah, and the University of California at Santa Barbara. You can see here a diagram showing the connections between the first computers on the Internet. It's important to remember that the Internet started in an era where computer systems were fairly primitive by early 21st century standards. Computer systems used command line interfaces, where you had to learn a basic set of commands, and this also meant learning the syntax for these commands. Interfaces like these were used for email, transferring files, and using supercomputers elsewhere on the Internet to do large-scale scientific calculations. In the 1990s, computer interfaces became graphical, which meant that programs could be more graphical and easier to use. The National Information Superhighway Infrastructure Act led to the commercialization of the Internet, and it expanded greatly. As a result, computer users could access the Internet for a relatively small subscription fee. The Internet today is huge, with about 500 million nodes and over 3 billion users on all 7 continents. Yes, 7. There is even Internet service in Antarctica, although it's only research stations. It has been estimated that the Internet handles over 2 exabytes of data every day. That is literally billions of billions of bytes of data. Although the Internet is a purely American invention, it is no longer solely American. And in theory, no single person, no single organization, no single company or government runs it. The only thing that ties the entire Internet together, other than the actual physical connecting wires, are the protocols, procedures, and technologies of the Internet. These have come about as a result of common agreements between network providers. The single closest thing to governing responsibility for the Internet is ICANN, the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers. ICANN is responsible for assigning domain names, which is how people know the sites on the Internet, and IP addresses. IP or inter-network protocol addresses are the numbers that serve as addresses that the internet uses to route data traffic through the internet. The infrastructure of the internet has three tiers. Let's start by talking about Tier 1, where the networks that comprise it form the backbone of the internet. This is a series of high-capacity routers and links that provide the internet's main routes, sort of our data's answer to the U.S. interstate highway system. The backbone is highly interconnected, providing many alternate routes through it. To continue the interstate highway analogy, if we were looking to drive from New York City to San Francisco, we would drive north to the George Washington Bridge and continue on Interstate 95 until Interstate 80 begins. And we would stay on I-80 until we crossed the Oakland Bay Bridge. This cross-country and cross-continental trip is very similar to what our data does as it goes through the internet backbone from Adelphi in Garden City, Long Island, to the University of California, Berkeley. Without high-speed, high-capacity lines, this would not be possible. Tier 1 networks these days are largely private and owned and operated by private companies, including AT&T, Verizon, CenturyLink, and NTT Communications. The networks that collectively form the internet are maintained by internet service providers, the companies through which we gain access to the internet. These ISPs form Tier 2 of the internet. If I want to read the New York Times online, I will do so through my web browser. The browser requests the Times homepage, and the request goes from my computer out through my router to my ISP. If the Times is not using the same internet service provider to connect to the internet, it will exchange data at an Internet Exchange Point, or IXP. The IXP will deliver the request to a content delivery network, which will make use of parts of the internet backbone. On the other end, it will be exchanged through another IXP to the Times Internet Service Provider, and it will be received by the Times web server. Their response, providing my computer with the Times homepage, will travel back, reversing the path that my request had taken. You can see all three tiers here, including your local provider through whom you are connected, the IXPs connecting different service providers, mainly along Tier 1. The routers direct your message along the correct route. Internet service is not free, even if we don't always get to see the bill. ISPs spend a lot of money on equipment and on infrastructure, and without this, none of us would be able to connect to the internet. These ISPs also have to spend a lot to maintain the equipment that they own and we need to use the internet. Tier 1 providers exchange data with other Tier 1 providers at no charge. Tier 2 providers exchange with other Tier 2 providers, but they have to pay fees to Tier 1 providers. Tier 3 providers pay to connect to Tier 1 or Tier 2. And of course, consumers pay directly or indirectly.